Welcome to the Not Badger for the week ending June 4th, 2016. Here, thanks to our hardworking serfs and our mud farms, we have compiled a collection of funny, interesting, and hopefully useful clips from our most watched shows. The incarcerated, I mean volunteer efforts, of our mud farmers have produced a delicious crop of mineral excellence. Enjoy the spoils of their hard work. First, we will look at the world without the male gender via BuzzFeed, as they cleverly claim to try to make the world without gender in Raging number 36.
A World Without Gender by BuzzFeed. Oh boy.
Now, I would rather have a world without BuzzFeed. The amount of material we get out of them is not worth the nightmares they give us, seriously.
Without gendered clothes, choosing an outfit becomes nearly impossible.
No, it doesn't. That particular task becomes easier. I can already see what you're doing here.
Okay, so they just pulled out a shirt they like.
You're really going for the stuff that's irrelevant. Like, without gender, we might not have firefighters. Or we might not have police. We'd still have criminals. Without gender, we might not have people in the sewers doing the shittiest jobs imaginable. But let's go for the clothing angle. Let's go for... And incidentally, I noticed he chose something appropriate for his gender.
This person is using a non-pink razor on their legs. It will tear his skin to rag.
Really? Okay, I'm starting to feel like my prediction is right. They're gonna go a bare inch. In fact, I think that they tried for an inch and failed at the three quarters mark. You're talking about the color of the fucking razor, but shaving your legs is gendered.
Can you imagine a species-free world? As in, a world with only one species? No food chain, no ecosystem, just one species of organism running around by itself. Given that life as we know it depends on and inevitably results in divergent speciation, the very idea of a world with only one species is really hard to imagine, except maybe on the cellular level. Our best guess, as the complex eukaryotes on a highly biologically diverse planet we are, is we would find it rather boring. Impossibly boring, in fact, and impossibly unbreathable. This world would very likely be on a completely different planet. And you may say to yourself, imagine a gender-free world. Well, that's much the same situation. It would mean undoing the diversity of life as we know it. It would mean going all the way back to single-celled organisms and starting again. Bacteria to the future.
The wage gap.
The wage gap. But, you know, nothing about the spending gap. I assume in this genderless world, that woman is just as likely as that man, to be paying a third of her wage to child support. I mean, they're not even peeking outside of the gender box, because they're still framing this all as women being victims of gender. Even though if they looked at the whole context of the gender gap, they would realize that saying a group of people that's spending as much, if not more, than another group of people that's earning more, that would not suggest the first group of people is victims, a bunch of victims, or they're lacking in privilege. In fact, it would suggest that they are privileged, because they have spending privilege.
And in a world without gender, many more people would have good qualifications, like in STEM fields, because there would be a lot more elbow room in universities due to the absence of gender studies departments. I must say, despite my initial apprehensions, your offer is sounding more and more tempting by the minute.
With gender-neutral bathrooms, a sexual frenzy would unfold.
This is from the people who promote shit like, don't be that guy. Promote shit where they think that every man on Earth needs to be taught what consent is. And now you're saying, oh yeah, all these men who need to be taught what consent is, let's give them more access to women.
I think only having to build one kind of bathroom is a step in the right direction. I think having to build a third and fourth bathroom is a step in the wrong direction, according to history and economy.
No, don't open that toy! It's
the one I wanted.
I'm just gonna say something. Lots of people talk about all of stuffed animals that are in the egg chair. People think that they're mine. They're not. They're my husband's. Because he likes stuffed animals. So what? That's not incompatible with being a man or being masculine.
Thank fuck for that. Oh, I'm not stuffed.
You're stuffed with my hand.
Masculinity will fall.
Why would masculinity crumble if men are allowed to be emotional? Why is that incompatible with masculinity?
Emotions are human, so men don't have them. Have you not been paying attention, Allison?
Femininity will rise up. Oh, their bodies are crumbling under the sheer weight of the couch.
Actually, we're fine.
I could lift that by myself. Do you know why?
That's a fucking IKEA couch, if that. They weigh like, what, 20 pounds? Like, I want to see that replaced with them carrying a refrigerator into a house.
Onium, take hold of these peers. The disgust and contempt she has for people not conforming to gender assumptions.
You can't do pastels. Here, try magenta.
Damn it.
Much better.
Magenta. Sweetie, the 80s called. It said you can keep it.
Without gender norms, men would paint their nails. And even men working in the sewers, or firefighters, or like guys who are building buildings and construction workers, road crew, they would all paint their nails. There isn't a functional reason why men don't usually adorn themselves.
That was the wrong color for him.
I knew it didn't look right.
He is more of an autumn.
In a world without the identities of men or women, BuzzFeed will become obsessed with the identities of autumn and spring. Down with spring harassment and fucking climate violence. Autumn people make up the majority of CEOs, blah, blah, blah. 1 in 5 spring people get raped in college. So everyone stop the toxic spring blaming, autumn splaining. Smash the faltriarchy. You have September privilege. And don't get me started on winter phobia.
Shit, this is 6 minutes?
Next up, Polecat cast number 64. Celebrity Insanity, where Amber Heard turns up the victimology and suddenly becomes an actress. Looks like Hollywood is rubbing off on her.
I'm reminded of an incident that happened not too long ago where a California artist, the same artist that painted a picture of Trump with a micropenis, and I think she has like a bunch of tattoos put on her, and it was part of like a performance art piece that dealt with rape culture or something. I don't remember exactly. I just know that she's a little, you know. And she took a photo of herself with a bruised face and a black eye, telling the story about how this Trump supporter hopped out of a pickup truck, shouted Trump 2016 and punched her in the face. And then after that, you know, without knowing whether or not that's true, I mean, the story sounds a little far-fetched. But after that, Margaret McLennan, who is another YouTuber, showed how that you can use makeup to make yourself look like you're bruised. And she basically demonstrated that by putting on makeup and then also making an outrageous claim. I'm not saying that the original woman is lying. I don't know. But it's all very, very fishy because she has particular views and she's a performance artist and she knows how to do this stuff. And she's also a very talented painter, so, you know, who knows. But I think that there is, this is cause for suspicion and skepticism when you look at the timeline associated with what's going on with Amber Heard and Johnny Depp. I don't know if it's connected, but Johnny Depp's mother dies, and then just after that, there's, I guess his wife's calling for a divorce, and then she shows up with bruises and claims that he's a domestic abuser. And there are lots of mainstream journalist sites, news sites, that are siding with her, that are saying things like, I have something brought up here, there are people whom you would have assumed would be rallying around Depp, the movie star's tight-knit circle, closing ranks and painting Heard's allegations that her husband of 15 months was physically and verbally abusive. They're trying to paint it as desperate and patently false. But why were so many people, 99% of whom have never met the man and will never meet the man, so quick to brand Heard a liar, not to mention a gold digger, a manipulator, and other nastier words? Essentially, it goes into this thing about how, you know, we should believe her, and despite what the court says, or despite whatever happens. This is actually before the final word came out, the verdict. So, just I'm siding with Hannah on this, just based on patterns that I've seen before. And I think that there is this idea that, you know, somebody like Amber Heard could easily do that and probably get retribution. For example, well, depending on how long this gets dragged out, whether or not Depp had actually done anything to her may not matter because it could, in fact, if it doesn't seriously do so, harm his career. And I wonder, because, I mean, we've seen this happen with other actors in Hollywood. Like, Robin Williams ended up having to work a large number of jobs, as many as he can get his hands on, because he had so many child support / alimony payments to make. He essentially worked himself to death. So, you know, I think that this is a real danger that can happen to people in this industry, men specifically. Jessica Valenti has gotten to the point where she is plugging herself on herself within herself on The Guardian. So she wrote, there's a piece in The Guardian by Jessica Valenti called My Life as a Sex Object, and it is a very long article that is actually an excerpt from a book she's trying to sell. So you are looking at an ad for a book by a woman who works for the website she wrote her long ad for, Adception. I'm not going to read it, but if you know Jessica Valenti, I think you know where this is going.
Yeah, Jessica Valenti is a sex object. I'm an astronaut. I jumped once. Really high.
So, I have one article by IGN staff from IGN.ca entitled, How Feminist Frequency is Helping Women, Real and Fictional. Strap yourselves in, because IGN
How do you help fictional women?
I don't know. That's a good question. We're about to find out.
We need a hashtag for that. We're fictional girl problems.
Yes. Just fictional girly things.
Oh, God.
Oh, for fuck's sake. Like, that has got to be the stupid... Okay, well, maybe that's a joke. Maybe they're making fun of themselves?
Make it happen.
Let's find out. Let's find out.
All right. In 2009, critic Anita Sarkeesian started Feminist Frequency with one goal: to make criticism, particularly from a feminist perspective, an easier subject for anyone to grasp. She recalls being a graduate school and finding feminist theory alienating and not as accessible as she felt it should be. Driven by her passion for the subject and desire to bring feminism to a wider audience, Sarkeesian began using a feminist lens to evaluate subjects dear to her: video games, entertainment, and pop culture. I almost read that as poop culture. I mean, it's basically getting to that point. Being a fan was a very nice fit for me, Sarkeesian told IGN in a Skype interview. I'm going to take those things that I love critically and talk about them to engage a wider audience. What things are you talking about that you love?
Okay, wait a second. Being a fan was a nice fit for me? What, did you try on various identities? That just is a really weird framing.
A fan is short for fanatic. I tried being a fanatic. That's not quite how it works.
I tried being a fanatic, and it just fit for me.
Somebody doesn't know how to fan right. Maybe it's, I'm going to try and think about this, and this is going to involve a little bit of speculation, but if her idea of becoming a fan involves trying to find something that is a fit, then maybe what she's doing is we're thinking about her around college, right? So perhaps her peers were into this stuff, and she thought to get social acceptance, she should also become a fan of those things. And then she looked at other things that they were into. None of it worked, but video games was okay, perhaps. Could this be a thing where, you know how women have a tendency to want to be, you know, accepted, like the social currency is important? So they might mold themselves around, you know, the interests of the people that are close to them so that they fit in better.
Yeah, to the point where there's an entire industry that exists just to capitalize on women's inability to decide these things for themselves instead of depending on their friends to decide them for them.
Which is?
Don't just jump into...
Well, there's the fashion industry, there's the makeup industry, there's the women's magazine industry, so I guess that's three.
Okay. Well, this is what I was going to say, because this is just really foreign to me. Just to use a recent example of something I became very fanatical about, I simply watched a TV show, and then I became a fan, and then I pretty much alienated everyone because I became a fan of this TV show. But they tolerated me.
I don't know what you're talking about.
No. Okay, all right. But anyway, so this is the progress of becoming a fan. You see something you like, and then you become obsessive about it. It's not, oh, I tried on being a fan, and I liked it. What?
Yeah.
What were you a fan of? I mean, when you say you're a fan of games, that doesn't even make sense. Which games? Why?
A critic does not mean tearing things apart, she explains. A critic means saying it is mostly good or mostly bad or some combination thereof, and I think people struggle with this idea. I'm smarter than everybody. They just don't get it. I'm just going to keep repeating myself with this really stupid notion until people start to agree with me, despite the fact that what I'm saying makes no fucking sense. It's just a matter of being able to hold multiple nuanced positions. It's similar to the way we have relationships with other human beings. It's not like your friends or your partner don't anger you sometimes, but you still care about them.
Think this multiple nuanced positions. No, yes. You don't even hold one nuanced position.
You don't get to use that word. That is our word.
Yeah, it's our word.
All I can think of is that
nuanced culture.
All I can think of is that cartoon The Critic, except in, what was it he used to say? It's crap or something
like
that?
It stinks.
That's what it is. It stinks. And Anita's line would be, it's sexist.
And you have to point it all out.
Yep.
It's pretty good, John Lovitz. Scott.
Yeah, you know what? Here's the thing. The first thing that grabs me, just because I guess I've been somewhat conditioned to look at these things now because of the events of the last 2 years, but who wrote this? Who was the writer behind this?
IGN staff.
IGN staff, that's really weird.
It was the whole team got together and they were in a huddle and one person wrote the letters and the others decided what it should say.
It was a collective thing?
Yeah, they were all around the keyboard.
And the thing that should instantly jump out to anybody that has kind of been grown savvy to these things over the last few years is that websites have been increasingly doing things like sourcing the writer as staff to get around native advertising laws and regulations and things like that. So that, first off, that just sets off a big fucking flashing light for me whenever I see something like that because of the experiences that we've had over the last couple of years or so. But then you read this thing and this just, it sounds like a fucking commercial. It sounds like this is a straight up PR release. That's all this is.
That's an ad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the whole thing to me just, it is spurious. It feels spurious at best. It
smells fishy. Say.
It smells fishy. No, we're not going back there, Hannah. We already went there. We've already been down that road. It just feels kind of, okay, I'll do it fine. It feels fishy. Yeah, so I would just say I'm kind of taking this whole thing with a grain of salt because I ain't buying it. I think there's something else going on here. It just does not sit right with me.
Tony8353 says it's a staff infection.
Oh, that was awesome. There you go.
Maybe that's why it smells fishy.
All right, I'm going to go ahead and do one more reading, and then we'll quit. We don't need to respond to it, because this is a positive thing, and it's not too long. It's called Confessions of a Recovering Tumblr Feminist. Yes, someone has saw the light, and they are healing themselves. Written by Tony, T-O-N-I. It's a female Tony. Nigga. All right. When I was in middle school, I discovered feminism. Always a voracious reader, I devoured every book on it that I could find, eagerly eating the words of feminists like Germaine Greer, Betty Friedan, and Naomi Wolf. When I was done with books, I turned my attention to the interwebs, where communities of social justice warriors congregate. Little did I know it, as a young teen, I tumbled headfirst into the rabbit hole of the social justice feminist orthodoxy, the perverse wonderland where up is down and everything is actually a manifestation of the patriarchy. Now, as a student at a woman's college, surrounded by this ideology, I've realized the naivete of my early eagerness. For me, feminism was an enticing religion. Raised in a home devoid of faith, I eagerly accepted its philosophy as my ticket to salvation. As I steeped myself in this type of feminism, the type that emanates from the online Tumblr echo chambers and the illogical, ideological enclaves of women's studies departments, it taught me a number of ideas and values I was eager to apply to my own life. For example, feminist ideology taught me that any opinions that were conservative or just didn't align with the party line were violence. It also taught me that the best way to fight opposition is to try to silence it. Don't like what someone says? Protest them. Shut their event down. In retrospect, the fact that I openly embrace an ideology that claimed that holding a conservative viewpoint is the same as life-threatening violence isn't just absurd, it's embarrassing. How was I so deluded? The advent of conservative speakers being deplatformed or harassed by screaming social justice warriors is a logical consequence of an ideology that equates conservative opinions with physical violence. This was seen most recently when Milo Yiannopoulos' speech at DePaul University came to an end when two social justice warriors ran onto the stage, hijacked the mic, and stood in protest of Milo's views. Where I lived growing up, people had been shot just minutes away from me. Sometimes on my very same street. I've woken up to the sound of gunshots, and two people I went to high school with have already been killed. Just last week, there were 9 shootings in 24 hours in Cleveland, with more that happened a few days later. Violence, real violence, is an omnipresent threat in the city where I'm from. When I went around preaching to my friends that homophobic or sexist language was an act of violence, someone should have called me a fool, slapped me upside the head, and told me to climb back out of the social justice rabbit hole before I made it my grave. Social justice theory also taught me about microaggressions. Rarely did I go a day without interpreting what someone said as such, as a personal affront to myself or one of the 7 marginalized identities that feminist social justice Tumblr gifted me. Social justice theory also taught me that anyone who said anything I didn't agree with was sexist or homophobic. For example, if someone brought up the fact that some research suggests lesbians and gay men have a disproportionately higher rate of engaging in domestic violence, the feminist rebuttal would essentially be to accuse the other person of being a homophobe instead of engaging in dialogue. Feminist theory also taught me that the best way to fight oppression was to call people out. Unfortunately, what feminism doesn't tell you is that running around making accusations of sexism towards everyone you disagree with isn't productive. Nonetheless, calling people out became some sort of competitive sport for me. In retrospect, I wonder if maybe I was a little bit too extreme of a social justice feminist. Not all feminists go around calling people racist or sexist, right? Dramatic pause. Not all of them, but many do. Many of my peers volley accusations of racism and sexism daily. When I look at their politics and the way that they advance it now, I think of my younger self. I think about the time I called my friend a racist because she was culturally appropriating Native Americans for using a dream catcher in a room decoration. Or the time I called one of my friends a sexist when he defended catcalling because it's part of inner city culture. Of course, not all feminism preaches the ideas I've described. Dissident feminists such as Camille Paglia, Kathy Young, and Christina Hoff Sommers carry the torch for a different kind of feminism. One that has its roots in classical liberalism and the promotion of agency, not victimhood. Unfortunately, this is not the type of feminism that appeals to most women. My blissful union with feminism ended in the same way that any long-term relationship does, with hurt feelings, a little embarrassment, and a pang of remorse over what could have been. I still resist the urge to accuse people who own dream catchers of cultural appropriation and calling any man a sexist if he says something I don't like. But I'm learning, forever haunted by my sojourn down the rabbit hole. That's it.
Okay, I'm sharing the screens.
All right, I will click on your face.
Yes. How the fuck is cyberbullying real? Ha ha ha, nigga. 276,732 retweets. 239,975 likes. Wow.
I'm surprised you haven't figured out an algorithm to take that down. Like, nigga. I mean, it doesn't contain the word rape, so dagnamit, can't do him on that. But it contains the word nigga twice, so do him. I need to make that a rule now.
That is the face of wisdom.
Well, no, it's not. It's not a hard R mic. It's not a R. So, and he is black, right. So.
Yeah, yeah. That's true.
But it might also be after the algorithm as well. So they might have shaved off however many retweets and likes they think we won't notice. Ah, oh, twatter, never change.
Yeah. Elliot Fryer, quick on the draw, you're an idiot. You show him, Elliot! You show him.
Oh my God, Elliot, standing up for the women's everywhere.
Do you realize, Elliot, what Tyler the Creator did when you sent him that? He walked away from the screen like, nigga, he closed his eyes.
All I can say is this. If you expect me as a woman to be upset and feel upset and victimized over something that you would laugh at if it happened to a man, then you are a sexist fuck. For reals. So if you think that if a guy complained about getting all of these really negative reviews of something he did in public and put on the internet, which is public, and he was like, oh my God, how can they have been so mean to me to publicly review this thing that I put on the internet? If you would be like, bitch, man up, then why wouldn't you be the same for a woman? Because you're a sexist fuck. You don't think women need to be held to the same standard of stoicism and toughness. And then you turn around, and when people recognize that women aren't held to the same standards of stoicism and toughness, you blame them for not thinking that women make good leaders. Ah! Fie upon your houses!
Now we will look at the shrinking and regression of former Marvel superheroine and independent agent Mockingbird in Irma Gerd cast number 75.
So the Mockingbird character has been around since the 1960s. I'm pretty sure that's how old she is. Yeah, she's from the 60s or the very early 70s. So we're talking like 50 years old now, okay?
Okay.
And the Mockingbird character was essentially like a secret agent, well-trained, you know, martial artist and master of espionage and so on. She was like a spy and she could fight and stuff. And she was actually made as sort of a counter to a DC character called the Black Canary in a way. Although the Black Canary had like powers, they decided that she wouldn't have any powers. She would just fight with sticks, scream of sticks that would turn into a pole, and she had all these cool gadgets and all that. But she didn't do any fighting, so she was very similar to Black Widow in that regard. And Mockingbird, she was part of the Avengers for a while. She was part of the West Coast Avengers. She helped lead the team. She was invaluable, always was. And of course, back in those days, comics were always, you know, they always sort of had something to say politically about stuff. Like, you know, we've had comics doing things during wartime that was like promoting people to go buy war bonds and to help keep the morale up during World War II. And during the time of the civil rights movement, comics were reflecting the times then. During the time of the war on drugs in the 80s, comics were reflecting those times as well. I mean, they've always been staying with the times and stuff. And the level of success that they achieved sort of varied depending on the ideologies of the people involved. But in general, people remember that stuff. Maybe it's just me, but it seems like as we get more and more comfortable and we reach a place where people feel like there's no need for more of this, the more really dumb they get with the way that they approach doing these things.
Where's the power source?
I don't know.
Like, seriously, if she manages to get something that can power a laser on someone's head, mm-hmm. a power source that's light enough that she's not, like, half a ton,
mm-hmm.
that's pretty impressive. With that kind of a power source, she probably could have her own line of electric cars that run, you know, 500 miles on a single battery.
Yeah, but apparently when this home ec teacher said get back to your muffin project, she just gave up on technology altogether because she never did anything after that. That was enough to completely kill her dreams.
Okay, so seriously, she invented something, and it's not even the laser that's impressive. It's the fact that she's created a battery that apparently is light enough to power a laser, and part of the reason why we don't use them as weapons is because they need so much fucking power. And she managed to create a battery powerful enough, or with enough charge, to power a laser, and that can be on a human's head at the age of, what, I'm guessing 12?
Mm-hmm.
Do these people not even freaking know, like, some... I don't even know that much about laser science. And I know that that's freaking incredible.
Yeah.
Like that has incredible implications for not just lasers, but just power. Anything that requires electrical power anywhere, anytime. She's essentially invented the world's greatest battery. And how? Did she do it in a home ec class with like bacon grease and flour? Or did you just slap this in here because just like the person who wrote this apparently has no knowledge of the feminist movement, the history of the ERA or the history of the Equal Pay Act or the history of even law so that you can contextualize all of this stuff. This person who wrote this apparently does not understand science either.
No.
Does not science yeah. either.
But she put a pie on her shirt. So totally get science. See? Pie.
So she's...
That's like... I know. That's the laziest... way of doing science stuff.
Okay, let's go to the next one.
Well, again, though, I've just to throw it in there, why would you bring your rechargeable laser helmet to home ec class?
If a teacher had told me, what the fuck is with this laser helmet? Why would I give a shit?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, unless I required the home economics kitchen, which was a crappy kitchen, by the way, to create my laser helmet, why would I care if the home economics teacher was unimpressed? When you're iconoclastic and pursue shit that nobody really either gives a shit about or really, really hates, you don't care about their opinion. Then this is part of the problem with this whole comic.
Mm-hmm.
This girl is constantly seeking out other people's opinions for what she's doing, which is a very female thing. It is. This is the thought this is basically displaying the thought patterns of the author.
This is the thing. That's the part that really gets me. These people think that they have nailed what girls want to read in their comics. And yeah, there are probably girls that did read this and they do like this. And if you look at the comments section, you can see a couple at the very bottom that are like, oh, we need more stuff like this. I like what I'm seeing. But the overwhelming majority of people, men and women, are like, this is just ham-fisted, pathetic, annoying shit.
Well, I mean, it's basically all it is if they took this Mockingbird character and then just made her a fashion model wearing clothing instead of a superhero, That's essentially what they've done, is that they've turned a superhero into a victim. And they've expected us to be like, oh yeah, this is empowerment. No, it's not. It's empowerment according to your definition of empowerment, which is so entrenched in the idea of victimhood. The idea that you have to be a victim, or you have to be perceived to be owed in order to have power, because your only power is in dictating what other people do, specifically men, what men are supposed to do to give you reparations for your victimhood, instead of recognizing your own power as a person, an individual.
But this is what I wanted to point out, because I'm sure that we have really spurred over every single panel and looked and discussed each one in great detail. And there are probably people who are thinking, well, you guys are really reading into this too much, or looking at this, you know, maybe you're like getting a little too out of hand or whatever with this. But the reason why is to let you guys know that the people who are making this, this is what they think of women. They're showing us what they think of women that would read comics. They're showing us what they think comics aimed at girls, or even just comics that feature girls, have to have, should have, in order to be considered good progressive comic book material. This is what they think it should have. And that means it says what they believe their thoughts on women is. That's completely different from boys, which is crazy considering that, you know, feminism makes the declaration that boys and girls are completely equal and the same, and that everything that they do is just learned or socialized behavior, and that there's no differences between them.
If boys and girls are the same, when does, you know, teaching girls the feminist victim consciousness, when does it become in and of itself its own perpetuation of gender roles?
Oh, from the beginning.
Well, the thing is that if there is no exit strategy for feminism, if there's no objective point at which feminists say, hey, yeah, we've achieved equality, then how do we know we aren't teaching girls victim consciousness, which is in and of itself its own form of a social role that's negative for women? Like, and there's no reason for it.
I finally realized that I was being unrealistic. I could never be like my heroes. They all had something that I didn't. A Y chromosome. Honestly, by then I had other things on my mind. Like most girls my age, I was obsessed with... Okay, so I'm not going to go on to the next page.
No, let's discuss this.
Oh, absolutely, absolutely, yes.
The feminists who wrote this, what they don't realize is the genre is about a fantasy in which you have incredible agency. And they are trying to inject their worldview in which women have no agency. And it's just, it creates the most god-awful... It's like going into the romance genre and saying, you know what romance really needs? Step-by-step instructions on how to replace the oil in your car. It's so ridiculous.
I thought you were going to say step-by-step request for consent every step of the way.
Well, yeah, that too. But in this case, I'm saying that what they're trying to do is they're trying to smash two things together that are almost complete fucking opposites. So if it would be if you went to the erotica genre and changed and switched out, say, you know what erotica really needs? It really needs highly detailed instructions on how to rebuild your engines instead of sex scenes. Because engine rebuilding is just the same as sex, right? Because you got parts going into parts. And nobody's saying, no, actually, you're not getting the point. No one is telling the feminists writing this that you are not getting the point of these comics. These comics are about celebrating inhuman levels of agency. And you are trying to create female characters that are defined by a complete lack of agency. And I had the sense that this was going to go meta. You're saying that girls are victims of the comic book industry itself. Because the comic book industry doesn't let girls be superpowered. That's the conversation that's having here. This isn't even about a story. It's about a condemnation of the industry.
Absolutely. And it's wrong. Just
and they're using
wrong.
A character. They're using a female character just to be like a puppet in their goddamn chick track.
Yeah.
All right, go ahead, Brian.
No, sorry, I was just going to say that it's completely inaccurate anyway. Because there were female superheroes shortly after there were male ones. There were female pulp heroes before there were superheroes. Like in the days of the Shadow and shit. There were female heroes probably going back as far as what we were talking about earlier. Like ancient Greece and in Japan and in, you know, stories from all parts of the world. In our mythology. But no, they never existed. Even though essentially superheroes represent a sort of modern mythology in many ways. But obviously not like the gods. It's just a whole different thing. But there have always been female characters. This whole idea that the thing that I could never be like them because I didn't have a Y chromosome is ridiculous, patently, absolutely. In the Marvel Universe, some of the most powerful characters are female. Wasp led the Avengers for a long while. There was a female Captain Marvel that also led the Avengers. The Fantastic Four's most powerful member is Sue Storm, the Invisible Woman. The X-Men's most powerful member is the Phoenix, a woman. Storm led the X-Men. This is ridiculous. This idea that the ability to have power is some man thing. Now, if she's confusing having superpowers with having agency, then Allison, you're spot on. Because that wouldn't work with their narrative. Because yes, that's what superhero stories are. It's about having, as you were saying, you know, all of this power or agency over yourself, but also using it despite temptation to use it selfishly, using it selflessly to make sacrifices to help other people and also be an example. It was never about representing men. Like, no male superheroes never did anything because they were doing it for men. There's no such thing as a male superhero says, I'm doing this for the men everywhere. That doesn't exist. But with female characters in their stories, at least people who write like this, they'll say this is for women everywhere, which is really odd. Men generally do everything for the betterment of everybody. Honestly, by then I had other things on my mind. Like most girls my age, I was obsessed with math and science. Most girls my age.
No, I've gone through high school and most girls were not obsessed with math and science. In fact, most boys weren't either. Most girls are obsessed with either the beauty ideal or the victimhood ideal.
Or both.
Because those are the two main roles that girls and women occupy, is being attractive or being a victim.
Do you think that there's a chance that one of the reasons why the person decided to write that I was interested in the same thing that most girls my age were, which is math and science, was a way of trying to convince readers that girls are actually interested in math and science despite evidence to the contrary? Like, it's sort of like lying to them, like saying, oh yeah, most girls like math and science. I'm saying this to you in the hopes that you will also end up liking math and science.
Yeah, they probably are trying to say that, even though it's patently... even not every boy has to be told every boy is interested in math and science to have an interest in math and science.
Right.
They just have to not care about other people's opinions of them, because boys who have an interest in math and science are also stigmatized.
Yeah.
Are probably even more stigmatized than girls who are interested in it. You know, they're called nerds and antisocial and spurg lords and other shit. They're insulted for having that interest. Mm-hmm. But the difference is we don't tell boys that being insulted should be the end of your life and you become a victim and you're incapable of saying, you know what, I don't fucking give a shit about other people's opinions, I'm gonna do what I want. We tell that to girls. We tell girls, and this is what's so fucked up about this, we tell girls that other people's opinions determine what they're capable of doing. We tell them that. Feminists tell girls that shit instead of saying, you know what, who cares? People can have their opinions. It doesn't matter. You do what you want.
I think this is the last panel, yeah.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah. So here she is in her posh, awesome
underground
apartment.
Underwater apartment.
Yeah. And she's still doing science and she's got all the stuff that she... I don't know. What is this, a real book? These have to be real books. I'm Okay, You're Okay. And Pembroke Welsh Corgis. Oh, she has a Welsh Corgi. Because corgis are so in right now. They're so in right now. All right. They are. They're like this dog that... I mean, my brother had one and I liked them and everything, but... Jesus Christ. So it says, no more sexism, no more racism. Female heroes are just as celebrated as their male counterparts. We won the war, ladies. Ha, just kidding. It still sucks. Well, that is just bullshit. Patent bullshit. This is the thing. Like, I haven't seen as much racism and sexism in comics as I am today with the current modern comic writers injecting their ideology into comics. When I used to read them, if you read like from the 1970s, I mean, this goes before that, but I'll just use the 70s for an example. When they introduced the all new, all different X-Men, so I'm going to use X-Men as my example since I just saw the movie last night, but I knew it was a really good example of it anyway. They had characters from all over the world on the team. That was, you know, they're male and female. They had Ms. Marvel, they had Storm, Cyclops, Nightcrawler, Colossus, etc. Wolverine, you know, Shadow Cat, Rogue. There were men, there were girls, there were boys, there were women, there were people from Kenya, people from Russia, America, whatever. And they all worked together, and that whole conversation, that whole thing did not exist, didn't happen And nobody who read those books thought that. They didn't say, man, I wish there were fewer black people in these comics. That did not happen because comics readers were enjoying the escape and they liked seeing them work together. And, you know, like there wasn't what we have today where it's like, oh, I wish there were fewer men in comics, or I wish that there were fewer straight guys, or there were fewer white guys. That didn't happen, but it happens today. How is it worse now than it was in the 80s when you guys are the ones claiming this is as good as it's gotten and it's, we're still have a long way to go? No, it's bullshit. It still sucks. That's a lie. It's just a lie.
It didn't suck at all, no. Ever. One of the reasons why I suggested this, Brian, is I wanted to talk about my own comic.
Okay.
I don't know if that's acceptable.
Yeah.
And I could share screens now, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay. Because there was something like, when I had a conversation, okay, just a little bit of background for people don't know. I have written a science fiction comic whose the main character is a woman. And recently, the science fiction comic is essentially, it's a story about the far future. Earth has sent out successive waves of colonization and they've started to interact with each other. And they have very different societies, often very different physiology. And essentially, so these successive waves of colonization from Earth have just started to meet up and interact, and two of the largest have started a war. And the female character's name is Ann Koa. She is a scientist, and she's currently, in the opening sequence, she's currently dealing with a massive decompression after the engine that she developed and built and tested underwent a critical failure and resulted in a hull breach. And that's where the story opens up. And what was interesting to me is that when I talked to some people who have read this, one of the people who read it said that he likes the female character, and he actually found the female character inspiring. And the reason why is that she appeared to him to have really earned the skills and abilities that she has. And I was like, when I heard that, I was like, but I never really show you. Oops, no, maybe you could, let's see how I can share this. I never really show her learning it. I never really show her, I don't go through this whole sequence like with Mockingbird where she's a student and she's doing science or anything. All I really show is her doing this stuff in a situation where all hell is breaking loose. And it's not like there's any enemies or anything, but there's this explosive decompression, there's electrical fires, there's issues with the air, and she is focused on fixing the problem,
mm-hmm.
like a laser. Even to the point where, in two cases, she's being distracted by other people who are concerned about the issue, because it is concerning. And she's like, yeah, don't stop distracting me, I gotta fix this. And when I was talking to him about his impression that she had earned her talent and the fact that I had never actually showed her earning it, we were trying to figure out why, and that was why. Because she was able to focus so clearly on the task at hand, even in at threat of her own life. And that's how you show empowerment. That's how you show a female character being able to do something. You show her as determined. And you show her the consequences and create a situation. You don't, like, none of that situations that they put Mockingbird in appeared to be in any way believable. Partially because Mockingbird is apparently a character who's still concerned about what her home ec teacher said about her when she was 12. I mean, if you look at all of the stuff that she's talking about being horrible, none of it rates a merit, a mention. It's all banal. I mean, this is her origin story? Her mom ignored her at an ER rally and her home ec teacher didn't appreciate her laser? This is it? This is what drives her morally and emotionally? It's so fucking trivial. Her victimhood is so trivial. So painfully trivial. And the fact that she wasn't accidentally turned into a super. It's such a petty, childish, immature. It makes her look petty, childish, and immature. That she's creating victimhood out of such insignificant events. Rather than focusing on what she can do, she's focusing on what she can't do. That doesn't make a good superhero. Someone who focuses on what they can't do and doesn't focus on what they can do. It doesn't make an admirable character. It doesn't make a character who looks determined, who looks like she's earned what she's gotten. Whereas, I mean, I don't even, with the character that I created, I don't even ever. And in fact, she throughout her entire progress in the story, and she goes dark places, and I allude to it even in the first two volumes, and she's had shit done to her. At no point in the entire story does she whine like this. Does she emphasize what was done to her? In fact, she deliberately de-emphasizes what's done to her. The thing that broke this character, and this is spoilers, I'll try not to be too spoilery, but the thing that emotionally broke the female character that I write about, the main female character that I write about, was not what was done to her. It was what she failed to do. It's something she failed to be able to do.
Yeah. Something that she has to take responsibility for.
Well, no, that's just, she just, the specific thing, okay, yes, spoilers, but, you know, most people don't read my story, so it's not a big deal. What she failed to do was she was a POW, she was a prisoner of war, and she lost someone in the process. And that's what broke her. She was a logistics, she was in logistics, actually the Army Corps of Engineers, basically, and she was an officer, and she lost one of the people under her command. And that fucked her up. Completely. Not being a prisoner of war, not enduring what POWs endure, which includes rape and torture. What fucked her up was failing to save someone. And that's the kind of character she is. And apparently it comes through even at the beginning. That she is completely focused, not on what she can't do. Because if this was apparently their version of Mockingbird in this situation, she would be focusing on, I don't know, God knows what. Some man isn't coming to save her from being ignored by her home ec teacher. Yeah. I mean, they've created a victim. They've turned Mockingbird into a victim, into someone who focuses on what they can't do and what's been done to them rather than what they can do. And it's pathetic. And that's not how you create an empowering female character. You create an empowering female character by showing a character, and this is an inspiring female character, not just for women, but also for men. You create an inspiring female character by showing them focusing on what they can do in times and places where people would focus on what's about to happen to them.
Mm-hmm.
Because this female character that I wrote could easily, and this decompression is happening, just fold in on, oh, we're going to die, or I'm going to die, but she didn't. She focused on what she could do to prevent further destruction, or her own death, or her comrade's death, or her colleague's death. And I've spurged enough on my own shit. And that's essentially what made this individual who read it regard her as an inspiring character and a determined character and a character who had earned her stripes. And Mockingbird, what they've turned Mockingbird into, is fucked up. I wonder if it's just the end of a medium. Like, when we see this shit happening, it's almost like the corpse beetles have taken over the corpse. Yeah, not even the death throes. It's like the things that are feeding off of the dead flesh are starting to crawl out. And when we see this artistic medium being co-opted by a really obvious political sentiment.
Oh, yeah. And considering, you know, what I was thinking was, I know that we've been going off and kind of criticizing the artwork and finding problems with it and stuff. And actually, one of the things that I'm asking myself is, and this is another reason why I want to learn more, is it possible that they're actually getting less talented people, less talented artists and writers, because the writing is awful, and it's the one reason to meet a quota. It's because they think, oh, well, we're going to make a book. I don't know, because I'm still having trouble finding out. But what if they just hired, you know, a female artist and a female writer because they needed more females, and even though these people were, like, subpar? I'm going to try to find out right now, actually, because I do know what issue number is. I just figured it out. So it is possible. Yeah, writer by Chelsea Kane, and the artist is Katie Nymzik. And the cover artist is another woman named Jolie Jones. So there you go. It's an all-woman team. This is what they made.
And this is what they turn they take these female characters who are defined by their agency because they're fucking superheroes, and they turn them into victims. And nobody calls them out on this shit.
Yep.
Nobody says, what the fuck are you doing? You know, this isn't like slapping a corset on Harley and making her sexy. This is totally changing the essential character of these characters, of these female characters. And they all become the same bitter, envious, bitchy, chip on their shoulder victim. They're all written exactly the same.
Here's a little bit of information. Here's a little bit of information about Chelsea Kane, the writer. She's a novelist and a columnist. She went to the University of California at Irvine and University of Iowa. She was born in 1972 in Iowa. She spent her early childhood in a hippie commune outside of Iowa City. Her father resisted the Vietnam draft, and her parents lived underground for several years. In 78, she moved with her mother in Bellingham, Washington, where she attended Lowell Elementary. She left to pursue political science at the University of California. She wrote for the university newspaper and became an opinion editor. I wonder what she wrote about. While in Iowa, she wrote a memoir called Dharma Girl about her early childhood in the hippie commune. One of her professors presented it to several others for review. This was when she was 24 years old. She's, I'm looking at her bibliography. I just wanted to get an idea of where her head is at. Dharma Girl, Wild Child, Girlhoods in the Counterculture, So apparently she believes herself part of the counterculture. The Hippie Handbook, how to tie-dye a t-shirt, flash a peace sign, and other essential skills for a carefree life. Does this cape make me look fat? Pop psychology for superheroes. So I wonder if that's how she got her job, writing this comic book. Mm-hmm. She wrote this book. I'm just pointing out, she's a writer with like a lot under her belt, and it's this book is that bad. And I'm sorry, but comics is not that difficult. You know, when you consider, compared to other kinds of writing. Now, Karen and Allison will try to explain and examine the dreaded pink tax in Rant Zerker number 60.
I'm bewildered, too. I'm bewildered that this is their new way of explaining that women are victims. And I'm actually going to get into why I think they're focusing now on the cost of women's items versus men's items, even though that is completely erroneous.
I-47, the woman's is $12.95. Then we have Levi's jeans. Men's, $68. Women's, Levi's jeans, $88.
First things first, men's jeans, straight up and down. Again, you're dealing with issues of a change in how the sewing is done. With women's jeans, you tend to have a bit more of a curve through the hips, so it's just going to be more expensive in order to accommodate the hips. And guess what? You can get straight up and down jeans for women that don't accommodate your hips. The only reason to accommodate your shape is to show it off.
Yeah, no, it really is. If you look at the amount of tailoring in each of these pairs of jeans, the women's jeans need to be more fitted.
So what we're witnessing here is the aristocrats are saying that their fitted leggings are more expensive than the peasant trousers. Yeah, because they're fitted and they have to keep up with the styles, so they have to be redesigned, and you're going to have a multitude of styles, which means that they're not going to be able to sell as many in one single style. So yeah, they have to make up the cost of production by increasing the cost. The more styles you get, the more expensive each individual style is going to be, because they know that they're going to sell however many of this, not men's 401, but unisex 501, because women can wear it too and nobody will comment on it. They're going to sell much more of that in volume than they are in the various fitted styles that women want to flatter their figures. So these are not comparable items in the slightest, like
yeah,
I said.
You look at it too, right? Like the guy is probably not going to be overly concerned with what his ass looks like in those jeans, you know, that is like super flattering for his ass. He's just going to be like, do I look decent? And she's going to be, you know, when she tries, he's probably not even going to try the fucking jeans on when he buys them, because he's bought like 20 identical pairs over the last 30 years, and he knows. He just goes into the store, finds the size, and buys it, right? She's going to try on each and every one just to see, look in the mirror, see what her ass looks like in them, and all of that. It's a completely different fucking market. It's a completely different set of requirements in order to market jeans to men and jeans
to
women.
Yeah. All of the shopkeepers are there for her, to help her out. Go ahead, Mike.
Yeah, I have to wonder if at any point they're going to look at pantsuits. Yeah, see what the most expensive pantsuit you can find is and how it compares with the most expensive men's suit you can find. And you'll find it's the opposite. Because suits are generally made for the male frame, the way the shoulders hang and the way it hangs over the chest and shit. It's specifically a male thing, and that's why there's more demand for tailor-made suits than there is for pantsuits.
And then they went over to seniors. They examined all the different products for seniors. Some of like the bladder control pads, mm-hmm. It would be the equal price between men and women's, but the women's would have like a 52 count, and the men's would have
60.
Exactly. They would have more. No, they would have more. It'd be like a 75.
Okay, so essentially they're saying that women's bladder control pads were more, where there were fewer, for they would have the same amount, but fewer. And I can already tell why. Once again, the guards for men are much more, like, they're just basically just wadded whatever.
Yeah, they're utilitarian. And
they're utilitarian.
The ones for women are actually very, very differently shaped. They're probably thinner. And, you know, like,
so... You can tell they're thinner already, just looking at the package.
Yeah, so I mean, it's not the same fucking product. I'm sorry.
No,
I'm willing to pay a premium for maxi pads that are super thin, that aren't going to show through my clothes. And if men are not willing to pay a premium for that, if they're willing to fucking
wear, why would they?
That you can sort of see through your clothing, then why should they pay the same amount?
We just got through looking at the pants. Men's pants are straight up and down. You know, that you're not going to actually see this gigantic bulky diaper underneath the guy's underwear and pants because they don't form fit. So if you want bladder control pads that accommodate your form-fitting jeans, you're going to have to pay more. Because no doubt, what's in those bladder control pads is much more expensive material because they need to make it as thin as possible. Whereas the men's is just bulky because nobody's going to see it. You don't see old senior men in form-fitting clothes like you do senior women.
Exactly. They would have more. No, they would have more. It'd be like a 75 count. Thoughts, five words or less.
Costs more. Paid less. Bullshit.
And yet somehow you still hold 60% of America's wealth collected as women.
Fucking amazing.
How the fuck does that work? Costs more for you to survive, you get paid less, and somehow you hold 60% of the personal wealth in the United States.
Okay, and here's the other thing. I guess they're okay with the stereotype of the sassy black woman here.
Well, yeah, of course they are. I don't mind that stereotype, okay? It's a stereotype for a reason. Lots of black women are sassy.
I don't know. It just sits wrong. I mean, they have the white woman, you know, carefully going through all the evidence, and then the black woman just reacts emotionally. It just, you know, that just sort of sits a little wrong. But whatever. It's okay. I mean, obviously Pop Trigger is totally PC.
Doesn't it just be a little bit like Operation Get Behind the Darkie, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, because, you know, she's going to wag her finger, and she's going to jiggle her head, and she's going to say, "Oh, no, you didn't." And all the white people can hide behind her.
And you know what? It's interesting that the aristocratic analogy sort of fits here, too. You know, that their soap, their food, their clothing, their accoutrements of life. Definitely for aristocrats, those would cost more. And definitely, aristocrats generally made less because they weren't the one doing the labor.
Well, they generated less productivity in terms of measuring it by dollars. The whole reason why they could make more money than the people who were doing the actual work is because they had control over how much those people get paid and could get a profit off of other people's labor.
Well, I don't know if they controlled how much they could get paid, but they could get a profit. It was called tithing. Somehow the money that the middle class and the peasants made ended up in the aristocrats' pockets. Just by the process of osmosis, government was involved somehow, you know, a little voodoo dance. But the same thing is happening here. Women's stuff costs more because they can spend more on it, or they're willing to spend more on it. They're willing to spend more on premium goods, because that's all you've shown here, is that women's items are premium goods and the unisex items are not, duh. And women are willing to spend more for premium goods, especially premium goods that make them feel feminine. But the paid less doesn't mean anything when you consider that women control at least as much spending, if not more, than men. It's fucking irrelevant. And this is where I think that they're coming from, because they know that this particular argument is coming down the pike. Women may not earn as much as men, but if they aren't earning as much men, but they're spending at least as much, if not more, then by definition that doesn't suggest that women are oppressed. So they're trying to find something else to buttress that, I think, because they can see that argument coming out. And what they're using to buttress it is that women's items cost more. Well, so what? Because women control more spending that they don't earn, in other words, to spend a dollar, a woman only has to earn 77 cents. Well, it's probably even bigger than that. It's probably more like $1.25. She only has to earn 77 cents to control that. Well, Karen just said 60%. So to control $1.10, that I know I'm doing the math wrong, but I can't do it off the top of my head. You know, she only has to earn 77, what a man earns, in order for him to control a dollar. Well, this is where, because they have more spending power, they can afford the items with a premium, the premium items. How is it that women can spend more than they earn?
When 75% of the personal items in the U.S. are purchased by women, whoever is purchasing them, they're being purchased for women. I don't think that the earnings gap is the clear-cut issue that they want to make it seem. Because obviously, if women are, not only women are spending more or controlling more wealth than men, but that both men and women spend more money on women than on men.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So essentially costs more because you can afford a premium because you're not earning everything you spend. Bullshit. True on tampons alone. I'm just going to go. I'm not going to react to it. I'm just going to go.
Well, this sucks.
What's with this stupid fucking bullshit? This just really disrupting me the wrong fucking way. And incidentally, men don't use tampons. So how the hell did you compare tampons to anything?
No, but he's essentially saying, and women have all these other expenses too that men don't even have. And
this is what you're making new victimhood out of?
Yeah.
God, this sucks.
Yeah, so you're just...
Really? You really think that fucking sucks? The fact that you have two options, one of which is more expensive than the other. Your threshold for victimization, for victimhood, is so low. And it's frankly appalling.
Well, I mean, look at these two women and their hair. And how much money they've spent on their hair. And they have. Versus this guy who probably paid like $17 for his last haircut. Runs a little peanut by DeWall or Wall over his beard every few days. And, you know, he might use moisturizer, maybe with sunscreen in it, and like Q-tips. And that's pretty much, he's done. He's ready. And he's willing to go out in public with that hair and that face. And then you look at what these women look like. And it's not just the hair, it's not just the makeup, it's the jewelry. Neither of these women are going to get on their back on a dirty highway shoulder to get the jack situated underneath the proper part of the car and change their own fucking tire. But this guy, if he has the know-how to do it, he'd just take off his jacket and just fucking get to it. Because he's wearing utilitarian clothes. He's wearing clothes that you can do physical work in. He could go work in a fucking field, working a plow or some shit in what he's wearing. These women, they couldn't fucking do that.
No, and it's as simple as that. You pay for stuff that's of a premium, that's higher quality. And not just higher quality, but has more design in it, more fashion, is not going to be moved as high volume as other stuff. You're exactly right, just comparing them. This guy's outfit was cheaper because it's not meant to be a fashion statement. It's just generic.
Now discovering it's not as cool to be a woman as it is to be a...
Oh, fuck. Oh, I hate that smug, smarmy shit. Oh, it's not as cool to be you, ladies. I'm sitting over here, I'm sitting pretty... Yeah, fuck you. Prick. I am fucking salted! That he can turn this situation into, oh yeah, it's shit to be you, ladies. Really? How? I could wear what you're wearing, guy, and pay exactly what you pay for your fucking outfit, and I could wear what those two women are wearing if I wanted. How does that make me the victim? The fact that sumptuary laws are on your ass and not mine. And because sumptuary laws are on your ass and not mine, my clothing potentially is more expensive. And if you don't know what a sumptuary law, it was the law that the cultures with aristocrats had in which peasants and the middle class could not wear the more expensive clothing. And even though that's not a law in our society, it might as well be. Because I can tell you, if he was putting on that flowery blouse with some leather pants and those heels... He's going to get shit. That's why he doesn't do it.
He's not going to be able to get a job in any office, let alone any factory, you know.
Okay.
Sucks.
What sucks?
They're just...
You have all of the choices!
They're just saying it sucks, because it really sucks.
You want to have premium choices and pay the same as men. So you want to have more choices, but pay the same as men for those additional choices that you have. Even though you have men's choices as well as your own. What the fuck is wrong with this world?
They can't see it because it's just... Their way of thinking is like...
They can ever see is their own victimhood.
Yeah.
What a fucking... Like, this smug cunt, they don't even call him out for... Oh, it sucks for you, ladies. Oh, yeah, thank God I'm not a woman. I'm going to make a prayer. And they won't call this smug cunt out for his bullshit, and they honestly believe this stuff. Unless they don't honestly believe this stuff, in which case they're con artists.
Like, should I start buying all my face products, deodorant, shavers, everything from the men's department?
Yes, you should.
You can.
If you don't want to pay... If you don't want to pay for those ladies' fucking products, go and buy them from the men's department. Go buy that VO5 3-in-1 and use it and see what your hair looks like afterwards, because the conditioner content of that particular product is much lower than it is in the woman's product. And because it's made for guys who fucking go to the barber once a month, get the, you know, a little off the top, and they don't have to fucking ever worry about split ends. They don't have to ever worry about that because their hair's not long, the hair's not dyed, they don't have to blow dry it, they don't use a flat iron, They don't apply heat to it. They don't apply massive amounts of styling products to it. So they don't need the massive amounts of fucking conditioner that you have to put in your hair to make it look like this. And so it's 90% fucking shampoo slash body wash with a tiny little bit of conditioner thrown in so that they can fucking wash their entire body with it and not feel slimy afterwards. That is what that product is, because men don't give a shit about having perfectly styled, shoulder-length, fucking flat iron, frosted-tipped hair.
Yeah.
You do!
Like, this is unbelievable. It's like watching an aristocrat saying, why should I have to pay for my regalia? Why should I pay more than a peasant? Look at trousers and jerkin.
Clothing is more expensive in the Gap than it is in a charity store. That doesn't mean the customers in the Gap are being oppressed. Now, the two kinds of it's the same. If you want cheaper products, then go to a slightly cheaper store. And if that's still too expensive, there's probably another cheaper store somewhere. It's supply and demand, and it just happens there's two kinds of people who demand better supplies: rich people and women.
It's not even a matter of better. I don't even think it's necessarily even a matter of better. I don't know that every single one of the products for women that are priced higher have higher manufacturing costs or higher per unit costs. I don't know whether that's the case for every single item. But women are willing to spend more, and they're willing to spend more on their vanity. They're willing to spend more on their shampoo and their conditioner and all of that shit. You know what I do? I go to the fucking barber shop. A unisex barbershop. I pay $17 for my fucking hair to get cut. I don't pay for styling. I don't pay for products. I come home, take a shower, rinse all the little frickin' bits and pieces that itch like fuck off, wash my hair with fucking Head and Shoulders, get out. I don't even need to own a hairbrush. I don't even bring a comb.
I'm sort of in the same position. I'm in the same position as this guy is. Except he's not calling her out. Me and Karen are like the guy. We wear utilitarian shit and we don't do a hell of a lot for our look. Therefore,
I keep my fingernails filed down. I have a nail file. Nail clippers and a nail file, and that's it. No nail polish, no fucking French tips, no nothing like that. I don't own any makeup anymore. I threw it all away because it had been 2 years since I'd last worn any of it.
Okay, and this is the thing. Not only does she want men to have to pay more so that she can pay less, she wants women like us to pay more so that she can pay less for all of her vanity, which is optional.
Don't complain when the check comes and the guy's like, here, I want to pay for it. I think that's the least we could do is pay for all this stuff. And then tons of other stuff.
Oh, my God. The least
simpering.
Pay for it all? Yeah, the least you can do is tithe to your fucking master.
Oh, it's just, no, because he's getting that feeling of being more powerful. That's what he's enjoying. And gracious, and like, it's a noblesse largesse or whatever. Oblige.
Noblesse oblige?
Yeah, people, something like that.
Sometimes people insist on paying for dinner, like when you're out for a restaurant, and they get really offended if anyone even suggests that they pay for their own part. Particularly men have this habit. They really take it personally that they insist on paying for everyone's dinner. I've never quite understood that, why you would take it so personally. Yeah.
It's a sign. It's social posturing. It's science posturing. It's a sign of status.
I'm going to take care of you little ladies. It sucks to be you.
Not just women. And my dad, and like, because my parents used to go out, you know, once a month with this other couple, and they would go someplace nice, and they would buy dinner, and then my dad and Johnny would spend about 10 minutes arguing over which one of them has the check. You know, oh, no, it was your turn last time, this time it's my turn. No, you're remembering wrong. You totally paid last time, it's my turn, blah, 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 right? And they will argue and argue and argue over this, and finally one of them ends up having to give up, and then they go out for drinks afterward, and the whole time the guy who paid ribs the other guy over what a cheap bastard he is that he didn't pay.
It's right? Basically, I think it's in this case, I think it's just basically him saying, yeah, I'm the adult in the room, you're the children, I'm the adult, I'm the one who's providing for you guys because you're incapable. And he's enjoying that. He's really, really, really enjoying that.
Well, because it's a way of males gaining status, you know, and particularly among other males. is to be able to say, I'm financially successful. I'm so successful I can be this generous. It's the product of a gift culture.
Do people realize what's going on here? They are establishing a hierarchy of agency with him on top and them basically under his feet being his bitch.
Yeah, they've gone right back to the start. Like, this whole thing happened in the first place because men pay for women's shit, so women essentially have men's disposable income, so they use it to buy more shit for themselves, which happens to women and stuff. And here we are at him completing the cycle.
I stare into the abyss, and then I say, let's do some more.
And encourage the consumer to be aware of what they're purchasing, as well as the retailer and the manufacturer to create change, but at the same
create change, which is basically cheaper premium products. Where's the cheapness going to come down the supply chain? I mean, yes, some of those products were just more expensive because they're logos. That still is added expense in terms of design. But some of those products were actually definitely more expensive innately, like having special absorbent gels instead of just bulky cotton or whatever they had in the men's diaper or whatever. So how are we going to equalize these payments? Are you going to just charge men more for less goods? Like, that doesn't even make any sense because you also could buy those goods. So you're just going to be screwing yourself because you won't be able to buy the cheaper option anymore. Are you saying that we make women's items cheaper? Who pays for that? I mean, if you're going to make women's items cheaper, who ultimately has to pay for that?
Well, and then what use is that Abercrombie & Fitch logo if the t-shirts are cheap? Why would you even buy it? You're buying it for the illusion of
status.
Exclusivity. You're buying a shirt essentially that announces, I paid a fuck ton for this shirt. That's the only reason you're doing it.
Well, let's see what the person who's probably very difficult to live with said.
Women are the ones that will purchase more or pay more for a product.
Yes, because you have more spending power. You just said you are the largest consumer group. What do you think happens?
Well, and not just that they have more spending power. They're less likely to be the ones that have to earn that money.
Yeah, but what happens when you are the largest spending group on the planet? People give you more options because you won't spend the money on them.
But I also want to draw attention to this one thing, right? Because I was in the store with my son, my 13-year-old, and he saw these sort of nostalgic, limited edition 6-packs of Coca-Cola in little glass bottles. And they were like ungodly fucking expensive. And he was like, oh, that's so cool. We should get some. And I'm like, I'm not paying fucking $9 for essentially 2.5 cans of Coke. And he's like, but they're so cool. And I'm like, okay, you know, one day, son, you're going to have to go out and earn your own money and pay your own bills. And you're going to think that $12 an hour, that's a lot of money. Oh my God, I would only have to work not even an hour to buy this fucking 6-pack of Coke. Yeah, no, except for that all of your necessary shit has to come out of that hourly wage first. And by the time you've paid for all the necessary shit, the rent and the electricity and the fucking cable and the internet and the phone and all of that stuff and all of your taxes, you will be essentially making $1 an hour. $1 an hour. You're getting paid 12, but you're only earning 1. And so you would have to work 9 fucking hours to pay for this 6-pack of Coke. Okay, you'd have to work 7 hours longer than if you bought it in cans. Is it worth it now, son? Because that is what people who actually have to fucking earn the money live with every day, is that calculation. And the people whose lives are fucking subsidized by assholes like on this panel, who's like, oh, you know, the paying for dinner is the least we can do to help you ladies out. If these women had to pay their entire fucking way, through the sweat of their fucking brow, through money that they honestly earned on a fucking paycheck, and then purchased everything for themselves, they wouldn't be spending the way they do. They wouldn't be paying more than they had to. Because I can tell you, as somebody who spent fucking 15 years of marriage living under the poverty line with 5 fucking children, 3 of whom we supported full-time, 2 of whom we paid child support on, I can fucking tell you that when you're scrounging around in the fucking couch cushions for money for groceries, and you're standing there at the dairy counter, and you're looking, and you're like, oh my God, do I buy milk or do I buy juice? Because I can't afford both. You know what? You're not thinking, oh, $7 for a liter of Tropicana. That sounds reasonable.
Well, you're certainly not going to Abercrombie and Finch and thinking, wow, I would only have to work 77% of what a man would have to work to buy this.
Supply, demand.
I think the important thing is that consumers are aware.
Aware.
And then don't buy into things that are quote-unquote sterile.
I just can't believe this.
No,
she's advocating. They're saying, like, Karen, let me get this the fuck out. I'm sorry, I'm going to ram this through. They are saying that consumers need to be aware that the largest consumer body on Earth needs to have more consumer power. This is what they choose to bring awareness to. And then they mock the idea of caring about sweatshop labor in order to do the very, very crucial task of giving the group of people, American women, who already control the largest amount of spending on the planet, give them more power!
Well, I don't know. I don't know if that's what she's saying. Go back a few seconds.
Aware. And then don't buy into things that are, quote-unquote, stereotypically female.
Yes,
men. Don't spend the extra...
She's actually giving practical advice. She's just like, be aware... This is what's going on. Be aware that they're charging you a premium
for feeling feminine
labeling, and be aware of, and don't necessarily buy into it. Maybe you should go into the men's section and buy the men's fucking Lubriderm for a dollar less than the freaking women's Lubriderm lotion moisturizer.
But it might not work as well.
No, I buy the men's, and it works just fine. And, you know, like, so essentially, like, there are some products that charge a premium simply because women will pay more. That is just a reality. Women will pay more.
What are they paying for? They're paying for feeling feminine.
Yes, and so don't buy into it, because nobody's going to see you fucking...
Yeah, don't buy into wanting to feel feminine.
Don't buy into the whole idea of, like, that anybody is going to care what color the razor was that you shaved your legs with in the shower. Nobody's going to notice if you used a blue razor or a pink razor. Nobody's going to fucking know. Your legs are going to be nice and smooth, and off you go. And you can still feel feminine, even if it wasn't a product, a razor, that was targeted specifically to make you feel girly.
Yeah, but recognize that being made to feel girly is another aspect of a premium product.
Yes, you know, well, of course it is. It's obviously a marketable commodity.
Can you think of a product that's designed to make men feel manly at all? Oh, hey, GTA... shitload more expensive than Farmville. Does that mean males are being oppressed?
Because okay, they're getting yeah, I know.
Let me just put it this way. Given all the fucking penis enlargement shit that lands in my fucking spam box, you know, click here for good deal, you know, your
penis. Yeah, we've all experienced them, Karen.
Yeah, but you have all kinds of marketing targeted towards men to make them feel more manly. Even just things like fucking tickets to go see a hockey game or something like that. The actual experience of a hockey game is objectively better in front of a TV with an announcer and with cameras following the puck, cameras, you know, showing replays and all of that in slow motion and all of that stuff. The experience itself, from an objective standpoint, is better to watch it on TV at home. But there is something primal about being in the audience that really appeals to men, and it appeals to men more than women, because every time I've ever been to a fucking hockey game and there were women around, all they did was spend all of their time fucking gossiping about shit and not paying attention to the game. They are not there for the game. The men are there for the game, for the most part. And, oh, of course, the tickets were $120 for these two women to sit around and drink fucking cappuccinos and gossip.
Well, I think I like Mike's point, because it's really concise. The gaming experience, men have to pay premium for a more masculine gaming experience than women. Why aren't we talking about the Farmville gap? What about the Bejeweled gap? Why should men have to pay so much more for games than women?
Well, because those
women
games
victims
are
victims in both scenarios.
The games are different, right? And they are. And there's more work that goes into the AAA games, particularly...
Balderdash! It is actual sexism against men to force them to pay more for the games that they like. I can't believe it. We should make this a plank in the men's rights platform.
Are we going to make women pay more for Farmville, or are we going to make men pay less for Grand Theft Auto?
Well,
that's
obviously...
That's sarcasm when we say Balderdash. That's a safe word that means we're being sarcastic.
No. I'm being serious. No, I'm being sarcastic. Why do we have to say the R? No, I know why.
It's because these people think this way, and then when we turn it around and we try to show how ridiculous it is for them to be thinking this way, people take us seriously. You know, like, there are literally still supposedly intelligent, educated human beings out there in the world who believe that meninism is a real thing. It's an actual form of...
You're being trolled, idiots. But this all comes down to this. If we were reversing this, gender reversing this, we would be arguing. And this is why, you know, men's rights activists, not really where feminists are yet. Maybe in a grand future where men are wearing short shorts and cleavage-enhancing tank tops, in that rare future, men's rights activism will be comparable to feminism. But the fact is, nobody, no men's rights activist on the planet is going to argue that men are being discriminated against because their games cost more than women's games. But this is the argument that these people are making.
And lastly, we will talk about sex with cartoons and feminism. Don't ask. With Fireside Chat number 35, Nicole Sund.
So you said you're going to do a video about rape culture?
Yeah, I am. And well, spoiler alert for anyone who would be watching. The idea was that I was going to talk about how rape culture, as defined by feminists when you ask them, is usually not only just that rape is very prevalent and very accepted, but also this idea that we're encouraging it whenever we make a rape joke or when we say, like, that person deserved to get raped or we're victim blaming and things like that. And I want to sort of bring up those examples and then talk about how there is a rape culture in the West, but that, in my opinion, it exists within prisons and, like, prison rape culture. And then talk about how that affects prisoners, etc.
When you say prisoners, do you mean just across the board, just, like, male prisoners included in this?
I was going to try to cover both, but actually what made me want to do the video was someone showing me the statistic when you, and I could be wrong on this because it's been a few years, but someone showed me the statistics of when you look at the total number of men that have been sexually assaulted that are incarcerated. You compare that to the total number of women in the entire U.S. who have been sexually assaulted. The number for men in prison is higher, which kind of blew me away. So that was something that I thought was worth addressing.
I can confirm that for you. The statistics do indicate that. And what's an interesting facet of that is the majority of the sexual abuse going on in prisons is actually with men. And the reason why the majority of victims are men is because the majority of prisoners are men. But what's happening in prisons is, if you look at the statistics, the majority of these male prisoners are being sexually abused by female staff.
Ooh. Yeah.
And if you look at the majority total proportion of victims are male victims, not proportion, sorry, the total absolute number of victims are male victims of female staff. If you look at just proportions, so that's scaling for the size of the populations, the largest proportionate number of victims is female victims of female inmates.
Wow.
Yeah, and it's really, like, when you fall down this rabbit hole, it gets really interesting, because if you look at even numbers out of wartime, like wartime rape, 40% of the women who are victims of wartime rape report a female aggressor. So this is not just a rabbit hole for male victims, it's also a rabbit hole for female victims who aren't usually counted as well, and those are victims of other women. So I will pipe down now.
No, yeah, thank you for confirming that. Yeah, it's the kind of thing that I think is really ignored by, you know, and I hate to say feminists these days, but it's something that, you know, here's something that's actually really happening, and it's at home, it's right here, and they're kind of quiet about it, and they're talking about, you know, sexist air conditioning instead. So I feel like it's something that needs to be discussed.
Yeah, that's a good point. Sexist air conditioning or man spreading, like, seriously. Yeah. Now they're talking about the pink tax.
Like, and also gay men are no longer considered a protected class of people anymore.
Apparently gay white men are the problem.
Mm-hmm. Gay white men, that's right, gay white men. Gay black men are okay.
Yeah, although I'm pretty sure that gay black men will be thrown under the bus eventually.
Oh yeah, they're next, or you know, it's going to go into LGBTQ+. And they're going to start ranking people within that collective.
Yeah, they're going to be deciding who's going to be ejected next.
When you were in college, did you see a lot of this sort of gender conversation coming into classes where maybe you thought, does this belong here? Not like gender studies courses, but I mean other courses that weren't gender studies courses.
Right. Luckily, it hadn't really seeped into biology yet at the time. My boyfriend, who was an anthropology major, was saying how one of his teachers was trying to teach them that there was no physical differences between the races, for example, bone structure, or between men and women in, like, any physiological sense. And he was, like, trying to say, no, that's not true, though. Like, if we look at this, and she was like, no, this is what you're learning now. There's no difference. Okay. But for me, biology, because I'm mostly, like, a molecular, cellular biology person, it was never a gender issue. Although, I do remember reading about a feminist biology class that was offered at, I don't know, some school on the East Coast or in the Midwest, And they were just saying how, well, we want to redefine how we discuss biology. So, for example, when we're talking about, you know, an egg and a sperm, and the sperm is penetrating the egg, we don't want to say that. We want to say the egg envelopes the sperm, because that way we're not implying that there's, like, this patriarchal penetration going on. It's like, why? I was like, you are way overthinking this. I was like, this is a critical analysis literature thing. It's just
so now the egg is sexually assaulting the sperm?
It's right, I don't know.
Beyond, outside of its will, the sperm was just sort of hanging out. All the other ones were just looking to get bizarre. In there and die. But the egg chose really weird.
Yeah, I felt part of my brain just die. Did anybody else feel that?
I could hear it.
Could you?
It sounded like loose change falling from your pocket. That said, I think we need to start redefining biology so that we can include the Ten Commandments and the virgin birth and the Great Flood should be part of our history class, and dinosaur bones were put there by the devil to trick us. Nobody would put up with that shit. There'd be no way. I mean, granted, there are parts of the world where people are trying to do it, but by and large, we understand that that's stupid and a bad idea, and so we debate about it. But this, you know, the universities, like a lot of them are okay with it. Although I am learning from people that I'm speaking to that there are people within academia that are really getting sick of it. But they don't know that they can do anything about it. They're afraid because this is their livelihood and they don't want to endanger their jobs. But I think if enough people talk about it enough, they'll get sick of it. And I'm noticing more academics are starting to talk about it.
I'm really hoping that we've already surpassed the hill of, like, peak crazy and we can start reclaiming it. Would be nice.
I think we need a teacher's gate so the teachers can rise up and then be told that teachers don't have to be your audience anymore.
Yes, teachers don't have to be your audience.
Teachers don't have to be your teachers anymore. Go to Tumblr.
You can go to Tumblr and learn everything you need to know about genders.
Gender and psychology. Oh, my God. It's an amazing place. It's a learning institution of the highest caliber is what it is. It really is.
Whew. Runs on feels.
You would think, especially, you know, through all the stuff that gamers went through in the past couple of years, that me calling myself a feminist wouldn't have made them jump to conclusions about what I believe in and what my opinions are, and, you know, that I'm willing to talk to people about this kind of stuff regardless of this label I was hoping would be more indicative to people, but it wasn't. You know, it was just like, oh, she's a feminist, she's one of them. So it felt like I can't win either way, you know? So I just kind of gave up on everything.
Yeah. And, you know, even if you are a feminist, if you aren't, like, saying the stuff that they want you to say, like, if you're not going, towing the line, as it were, they'll just basically oust you as not a real one. They do it with Christina Hoff Sommers. I've actually tried to do that same sort of logical approach where, first, I try to present arguments against feminism with anti-feminist stuff that I found, stuff from, you know, guys that I've seen, like MGTOW. This was, like, a while back when I was first sort of discovering this. And people dismiss it out of the hand. Oh, it's a man saying that, so that's obviously not worth my attention because a man said it. Then I found, like, Karen and Allison and, you know, the Honey Badger videos, like the early ones when they were on Blog Talk Radio, and I was, like, my mind was blown. I was like, oh, my God, there's a woman doing this. And actually, when I look back on this now, it seems so strange that I would be so surprised that a woman would care about men that much. And I know that sounds really messed up, but I think that there's something really shocking for most guys that generally don't talk about their problems, or at least the problems that they think that, you know, you get a sense that something is wrong, that things are not working out the way you expected, that your life is not what you thought it was going to be, and you start, as a man anyway, you start thinking, what did I do to put myself in this position, or what can I do to change these things? What are the challenges? I'm trying to get a solid idea of what my obstacles are so I can better overcome them. And then you find there are other men talking about the same stuff that you're thinking about, and they're saying things that you never considered. And then you try to share these ideas, and they're coming from all kinds of other issues, like dealing with politics and feminism and the breakdown of the family and so on, and even economic things, where you thought you had this male privilege that you were supposed to carry with you, and that as a part of it came a bunch of obligations to help people that were, you know, like doing worse than you were. And then you come to discover that all that's kind of horseshit, and it really isn't based on your identity or your sexuality or your race or whatever. but rather it's more of your individual merits or lack thereof. And on top of that, you know, as a man, you actually have problems and you may not have even considered them. And so first you find men that are talking about it and they're being frank about it and they're, you know, speaking about it openly. You think, as a man, oh my God, this is amazing. I got to share this with my friends. I think that this is going to help them, because even though you come to realize that you're more vulnerable than you thought you were, one of the benefits of it is that now you know what you can address. Now you know where the problems are. Like, men like to fix problems, but they have to know what they are. They need to see where the break is so they can repair it. And then you just go to share this with people and they dismiss it out of hand because a man wrote it. And then you come across a woman that's saying this stuff. And she's articulating it maybe even more clear-headedly, maybe partly because she's a woman and she's sort of looking at this from the outside. And that's even more mind-blowing. And part of it is because there's a woman that cares about men's problems and speaking about it in an honest way. And you genuinely get the sense that this person really wants to bring these things to light and discuss them. And the fact that she's a woman is almost like she's putting herself like a bodyguard that puts themselves in the line of fire for you. And that's a really novel feeling that a woman would do that for men. And so you share that information, you try to spread that to people, and feminists will dismiss it anyway. They'll say, well, that woman is a traitor. That woman is not one of us. That woman, she doesn't know what he's talking about. She's an idiot. Oh, she's a traditionalist. She wants to be barefoot and pregnant in the kitchen. Whatever it is it takes to throw them under the bus. Then you try to bring them a feminist woman, and they still find a way to dismiss it. So, because when I did with Christina Hoff Summers, it was one of her videos. I think she was doing some work through Prager University, and so she had a couple of videos through Prager, and that was where I first found her. And I was surprised not only that was there a woman talking about these problems, but it was a woman who said she was a feminist that was talking about these problems. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. I got to share this. There's no way people can dismiss this now. But then they would still find a way to do it. They would say, well, Christina Hoff Summers, see, she says she's a feminist, but she's working with Prager University, and they're known as like a neocon right-wing group, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, well, I guess I can't win with you guys. It seems like you don't want to address any of the arguments that are being put forward. It doesn't matter who it comes from. The only thing that seems to matter to you is the fact that they're not saying what you think the truth should be. And so you're trying to find other ways to dismiss them, either by guilt by association or the fact that they're men, which just immediately makes them bankrupt of any credibility, or the fact that they're women that have walked off the plantation.
I wanted to add to that. For some reason, despite the fact that apparently feminism is only about equality, they certainly know when they want to throw somebody out of their movement. Like, they seem to have some criteria for saying you're not really a feminist. Whether or not you identify as a feminist, I don't have to listen to you. Because I do that with Christina. I mean, I'm not going to judge feminism by Valerie Solanas, necessarily, because she can be conceived as a lone nut, even though they still often teach her work. But I am going to judge feminism by what it chooses to exclude, or who it chooses to exclude. Christina Hoff Summers is excluded by other feminists who accept Andrea Dworkin. That is an indication of what feminism actually, or at least the people controlling feminism or the people involved in it actually believe. And it's right there in black and white. If you're going to exclude Christina Hoff Summers but include Andrea Dworkin or even Mary Koss or Susan Brown Miller or all of these other individuals who've said some really hateful shit or done some really hateful shit, then that says something.
It's this weird sort of like, it's like inclusive and diverse has become the new thing to be exclusive about. And I know that I get nervous whenever I see, like, when I go to conventions, if I see a diversity lounge, I avoid it like the plague. Or like if there's some sort of panel about feminism, even if I'm interested in the topic, I'm like terrified to go in there and ask a question, you know, especially after what happened to the honey badgers.
I was
like
gonna say, like,
yeah,
don't ask questions.
Well, that's the thing, is that it's like I as a woman feel unsafe going to a panel that's supposed to be about feminism, and it's just sort of weird. And I don't like to play the gender card usually, but it just seems so backwards. And it was interesting, I had a friend at work who is a poet and is a Christian, and I am very atheist, kind of slightly left of center, and I was outraged about this. But he writes poetry that is not, what's the term I'm looking for, non-religious, it's secular, but he once published under a Christian publisher. And he was invited, because of his poetry, to go read at a poetry jam or slam, whatever, in Berkeley. And after they found out that he had published before with a Christian publisher, even though his poetry was not religious at all, they said, you can't come here anymore because this is an inclusive safe space. And it's like, you're inclusive by excluding this Christian man solely because he is Christian, not even because of what he wrote. It's not like he was writing like, yeah, screw all the gays, kill all homos, you know, that kind of thing. Not even talking about God or whatever. And that pissed me off, which takes a lot to get mad about Christian oppression in the West kind of thing. Just like, ah, why would you do that? That's so ridiculous.
Well, I have a theory. When Christianity was in power and the bullies could use it as a tool to exclude and censor, they did. But then Christianity lost that power, so the people remaining in Christianity, the bullies went elsewhere, except for certain areas. And they went into social justice, because they can use that to bully people and censor them. And they went into this kind of so-called progressivism, which is, reminds me of the Calgary Expo's new updates to their policy, in which they said, we are non-discriminatory, so therefore if you promote any religious or political viewpoint, in secret quotes, that we do not approve of, you must leave. We're non-discriminatory. We're tolerant.
As long as you believe and say all the things that we want you to.
Exactly. And it doesn't even matter. If you are a black person who doesn't say the things we want you to, you're gone. You're a woman who doesn't say the things we want you to, you're gone.
Nicole, what do you think of men's rights advocacy? What do you think of men's rights activists? That's my question.
I feel like my experience with men's rights advocacy and activists has actually been really good. My first experience with it was watching the videos by Karen Strawn, because I've always been that kind of person who I can hear that, you know, men's rights activists are the evil bane of our existence, whatever. But until I, like, see something or watch something that proves that to be true, I'm usually like, I'm going to hold off on judgment, usually. I'm still human sometimes. But it's one of those things where I personally could call myself a men's rights advocate in the same sense that I could also call myself, you know, a humanist, an egalitarian, a feminist, or whatever, depending on what label of the week you would want to use. But yeah, I really like you guys. I like the Honey Badgers, and I like watching your videos, and I like hearing about what you have to say, because I do think it's actually really well-informed. A lot more well-informed than some of the feminist YouTuber counterparts that are out there, which is unfortunate, but yeah, I think it helps that my first experience with a men's rights advocate, the person who introduced me to the prison rape culture statistics that we were talking about earlier, was actually really good, and he was able to open my eyes to a lot of stuff about the incorrect statistics of feminism and looking into data and things like that. So, yeah, I think you guys are pretty cool.
We hope you enjoyed this clip show. If there was a clip from these shows that you think we should have shown, please leave a comment on the video and include a timestamp. Thank you, and Badger on.